blaming North Korea for a massive cyber attack. The White House says Pyongyang is directly responsible for the WannaCry virus that affected hospitals, businesses, and banks worldwide earlier this year. The White House says an organization known as the Lazarus Group is behind the attack. It's a hacking team working on behalf of the North Korean regime, and it's known for conducting the massive hack on Sony Pictures in 2014. Here with me is Lisa Garber. She's a cybersecurity lawyer. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
So, Lisa, how did the U.S. know that this was North Korea?
This investigation went on for some time. These attacks took place over a span of a couple months. As we know, they infected 300,000 devices. There were actually 150 countries involved, and the U.K. had already estimated. They assumed that it was North Korea after their investigation. The NSA put forth their statement that they thought it was North Korea. Really, what would be involved is a large-scale forensic investigation of the type of malware that was utilized, how it infected systems, things like that. They would try to look for trends.
And a lot of times when you think of these attacks and you see them, they're targeted at companies, not necessarily a foreign entity like a government of some sort like that. How do you go about targeting that, and when is it considered an act against a state?
Ransomware is really a tricky beast because right now we're seeing it amplify millions of times over in a cybersecurity consulting business. We're seeing it really infect healthcare and finance, as you mentioned, in the private sector. I think we're going to see it start amplifying in the government sector as well. As we know, the OPM hack of last year, there are government entities that are falling behind in technological standards that are definitely targets. But right now, in terms of companies, it's really healthcare and finance that are being targeted, and law firms are now following suit as well, trying to amplify security.
And we saw healthcare hospitals in the UK affected by this. It affects so many countries.
Exactly.
So where does international law apply when it comes to online?
Great question, especially because when it infected the multiple hospitals all across the UK, shut them down, really putting people's lives at risk. And sometimes you think, well, it's a cyber attack, it's occurring online, it's not in the real world, but it's really infrastructure. And I think President Trump mentioned this as well. You're looking at healthcare systems, you're also looking at electrical grids and water supplies, and cyber attacks could all infect all of those, whether you're raising or lowering the level of chemicals in a water supply or shutting off electrical grids. This is a huge problem. In terms of international law, it's a little bit of a mess because this is really an issue that doesn't squarely fit into any sort of legal box. The law has notoriously been slow in terms of trying to play catch up with the state of technology, and the U.S. has really tried to be at the forefront of trying to establish standards and guidelines for different companies to operate. But internationally, you're looking at the Budapest Cybercrime Convention, you're looking towards the EU for guidance, you're looking towards the UN. And I think what was mentioned earlier in the press conference is that the UN is considering sanctions against North Korea, and this is something that has happened right after the Sony attack. We sanctioned North Korea. We sanctioned North Korea in September. There were trade regulations at stake. But right now, a lot of this is really just trying to hurt their reputation, to attribute blame, to say, you did this, here's the damage that you caused, and try to embarrass people. And we heard the government say, this may not be something that's going to actually work. We might have to actually hack back. And I know that there are U.S. forces that are trying to examine what's going on in North Korea computing systems and trying to get advanced intel. But right now, the state of international law is trying to figure out, well, was this an act of war? Does it require armed force to combat it? And what level standard do you reach? And really, there's no definitive answer right now. There are different guidelines that are trying to be established, but we're really trying to play catch up.
You say we're trying to play catch up, but how do companies and individuals protect themselves from ransomware?
Ransomware, as I mentioned, it's very tricky. There are a couple ways to protect yourself. First of all, if you're already in a position where your computer is infected, shut it down.
Okay.
Because if you're trying to, and this happened in the WannaCry scare, if you pay the ransom, which is basically what happens is they take custody of your data, they encrypt it, so you can't access it. It's basically useless unless you have a passcode to decrypt the data. You pay in Bitcoin to decrypt it. Sometimes people were paying and actually not getting the passcode to decrypt their data. So you don't really want to negotiate with criminals. Not a great idea. Yeah. They're not trustworthy to begin with. Shut down your system and boot up from a backup. That's the best plan. If you don't have a backup, time to start thinking about what your system is. Get it in place to back up. How often can you afford to do it? How quickly can you get back up and running? These are business continuity issues. But then also really basic cyber hygiene. Patching your operating system. Having a procedure in place to change your password, having dual-factor authentication turned on so you have all these basic secure mechanisms, you basically need to be a safer house on the block.
And if you find yourself to be a victim of a cyber attack, what are your legal options?
Legal options are usually in the consumer realm. So first of all, you're going to want to, in the U.S., alert the FBI so that they can see if there is any evidence establishing some sort of trend, see what's going on, if they have any knowledge. And then also, you're going to want to get in touch with a forensic specialist who can preserve your data, see if anything was touched, especially if you're in the financial or healthcare field where there could be penalties facing you for certain standards of reasonableness in terms of protecting your data. But then also, you're going to want to look at what you can do moving forward in terms of being proactive, and that's updating your firewall, updating your encryption procedures, things like that. In terms of legal protections, you're probably going to follow the money. So you're going to see what kind of consumer protections you have. Go after the company who is trying to protect your data. Go after the credit card companies. And that's what we've seen in many of these lawsuits. Target, Neiman Marcus. Yeah. We've seen these major settlements come forward, and they're usually to protect consumers.
That individuals who were victims have filed against the companies saying, you didn't protect us.
Exactly, of victims of identity theft, and that's something we're going to be seeing for the Equifax data breach and the Yahoo data breaches as well.
Costing companies a lot of money, isn't it?
A lot of money.
Lisa Garber, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you.
Well, coming up on CBS.